Hi, in this video, I'll be talking about polymerase chain reaction. Now, as the name suggests, polymerase chain reaction. So it's some kind of chain reaction. And what is it used for? It is a widely used method in molecular biology to amplify or make several copies of a specific DNA segment. And in this video, I'll be talking about the technical details of it, its usage, the principle behind it, and the exciting story behind its discovery. It was an accidental discovery. Not accidental, but it has an exciting story behind it. So before that, if you haven't yet subscribed to my channel, please subscribe. So let's say this is a genome. Let's say a bacterial genome. And we want to amplify a small segment here in the bacterial genome. And we want to make multiple copies of it. And the way we do it is by polymerase chain reaction. So in earlier days, where polymerase chain reaction was not there, in order to amplify the DNA of interest, scientists has to take the advantage of bacteria. They use molecular cloning to increase the DNA of interest or sample of interest. So in cloning is just like a molecular copy machine. So the bacteria here is working like a molecular copy machine, just like a copy machine takes the copy and multiply the copy. So the bacteria take up a plasmid which has our gene of interest and take that up, and as the bacteria grows in ambient condition, along with it the DNA of interest also gets amplified. But there is a problem with this approach, because the time that it takes for growing bacteria is sometimes days. So getting multiple copies of DNA is pretty much time consuming at this point of time. So scientists were looking for a faster way. So they always asked, is this process going to be faster anyway? Can we do it? So can we reduce the extraction time from days to several hours or several minutes? Can we do that? So in order to do that, scientists were scratching their heads, what to do, where to do. But what they knew is the DNA replication, how does the replication happen, what are the enzymes important for replication. So they had a detailed idea about that and how the primer anneals. So one scientist, one biochemist in 90s, known as Carrie Mullis, was thinking about how can he designed a fast way to amplify specific DNA segment. So one day he was getting back to home from lab in his car, and suddenly an idea struck in his mind. So he stopped the car and he took out his notebook, and on a supermarket receipt, at the back page of a supermarket receipt, he has designed what we call the basic formula of PCR. And this thought experiment later he performed in lab, and that was the beginning of PCR. And today, in any molecular biology lab or biotechnology lab, without PCR, we cannot think our daily life. So it's just like a daily routine or daily thing for us, right? So, and this crappy paper give him a Nobel Prize, right? So how the idea can be translated into the lab and how he can win Nobel Prize, and whole molecular biology or biotechnology is now dependent on PCR, right? So the PCR reaction composition is fairly simple. So you have to add first the template of interest, like wherever you are trying to amplify the DNA from. Then you need specific forward and reverse primer. Need DNTPs. Definitely it's a polymerization reaction, so you have to add DNTP to synthesize or amplify that, right? I mean, imagine in a Xerox copy machine, if you don't put ink, then how the Xerox would happen, right? So DNTP would be like the ink. Then definitely the polymerase, so which is equivalent to the scanner of a copy machine. So the polymerase would polymerize the new DNA sequences, and definitely the polymerase is an enzyme, so it needs optimal pH and temperature, so it has a particular buffer in which it works, so it's a tag buffer. And this polymerase that is used is stack polymerase or thermos aquaticus polymerase. So it is stable in high temperature. So after mixing all these reagents, you have to put this into a thermal cycler. So each fragment of the reaction happens in different temperature. So you need a machine which can cycle between several temperatures quickly, right? And the thermal cycler PCR machine can do that. We would look at how. However, let's discuss the steps one by one. So first step is denaturation. Whenever there is increase in temperature till 95 degrees centigrade, the DNA strands would be separated in the template DNA. After that, there would be primer annealing. So after that, you reduce the temperature from 95 to, let's say, 55 or something around, and the primer annealing temperature depends upon the GC content of the primer we would be discussing in later. So the primers would anneal into specific location where we have designed it, and then the next step is extension, where tac polymerase would actually extend the DNA and try to amplify the region of interest. And after several repeat cycles of these same reaction, we are going to get multiple copies of our gene of interest, right? And if we run that in a agarose chill, we would get specific bands, and we know how big fragment we wanted to amplify. So we can definitely cross-check that what was our fragment of interest, and we can understand whether it is amplified or not. Later also, it can be purified from the gel. Now let's look at the PCR machine with a little bit more details. So how PCR machine can quickly fluctuate between temperatures? So actually, the PCR machine is nothing but a Peltier block. So the Peltier block is fairly simple. So it's thermoelectric effect. So depending upon what type of electricity and which direction the electricity is flowing, the Peltier module would basically change its temperature to hot or cold. So directionality of the electric flow matters. And with precise and advanced Peltier system, the block can be cooled or heated at a rate like 6 degrees per second, so fast. So that is how thermal cycler cycles between several temperatures so quickly. Now, the problems associated with PCR. So the problems associated with PCR are several. One problem is non-specific amplification. So in non-specific amplification, what happens is you get bands in all the regions where we're not supposed to get. I mean, you might get your band of interest, whatever base pair it is, but along with that, you are getting non-specific bands. So this is called non-specific amplification. So here you can see this is our desired band size. Like you can see in the other lens, there are like multiple other bands. So how they're coming from? So it turns out that in this particular case, your gene of interest or your sequence of interest is getting amplified, but along with that, some random sequence is also getting amplified, which is causing this non-specificity. There could be problem with template concentration, and as a result, there could be smearing. So when the template concentration is too high, then it can cause smearing. There could be also problem of having not amplification and having primer dimer. So if the primers are too much self-complementary, like they complement one another, so instead of annealing with the DNA template, they would anneal with each other. And instead of amplifying the gene region of interest, there would be only primer dimers left because they don't actually anneal with the template DNA to carry out the PCR reaction. So these are like several problems associated with PCR, but with optimization and with multiple change and all and proper primer designing, all these problems can be solved. So it's a great technique in molecular biology. Now, PCR could be used in several different applications. Some of that is like research, biomedical diagnosis, forensic purpose, genetic engineering, phylogenetic analysis, sequencing, and many others. So we would be having a different video discussing about the usage of PCR. Now, let's say one usage we discussed today. So let's say we try to use PCR for a diagnostic test. Let's say there is an infectious bacteria. I'm not taking the name of the bacteria, but let's say it's an infectious bacteria and it has a gene X which is characteristic to this bacteria and not present in human body. So this bacteria, let's say, infects a human. And what we can do to check the human is infected or not, we can take the blood from the patient, and the blood sample can be used to extract the DNA, and from the DNA sample we can try to amplify the gene X, because we know the gene X is characteristic to that bacteria and it's not supposed to be present in the human. So if we get a band size which corresponds to the gene X, we would assume that that individual was actually affected by the pathogen. And let's say in the sample we get band in a desired size, that means that individual is affected. So in this particular situation, the samples which came from patient 1 and 2 are actually infected because they have a band corresponding to the green segment here, but 3 and 4 are not infected, while the individual at 5 is mildly infected. So that is how we can somehow use PCR as a tool for diagnosis in medical field as well. So I hope this video was informative. If you like this video, give it a quick thumbs up. Don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Thank you.